Good morning.
Good morning.
You're here. Yay. I had a moment in the practice with the choir this morning where I saw something glimmering on the patio. I realized, oh, that's the sun. Nice. Glad you made it. Thanks for coming and joining us this morning here at First United Methodist Church of Santa Rosa, serving the greater Santa Rosa region for over 160 years. It's a wonderful statement to be able to make, and I'm so pleased to be a part of this community here. I'm on staff. My name is Doug Albertson. And not only do I get to welcome you, but I get to invite you to come on down to our fellowship hall after church this morning and join us for a cup of coffee or tea or juice. I bet you some donuts. We always like to make sure donuts. Ever since I was a boy, I've come to church for the coffee and the donuts. I just want to say, good traditions to carry on. Hopefully you're well and you've taken a minute to check in, gotten the pew pad started. We have a sign-in process if you're on the center aisle. We've had a lot going on in the church over the last several days, so things may not be back exactly where we expect them usually, and you know, we just make it work somehow. But the United Methodist Women were here in full force from the conference, all over the conference area, holding their events. Actually, it was Friday and Saturday, I think. They had 2 days of events here, so very pleased to be able to host them this past weekend. And then I also want to make a few announcements that are in the bulletin. One is on that orange card. Hopefully you found that this morning already. This is a chance to have dinner with the pastors. Guess who's coming to dinner, Pastor? Well, we don't know yet. But you can be one of those who comes to us. We actually have two at the pastor, each of the pastor's homes, and once at Kathy and Norm Bryan's home, too. So we can kind of allow everybody a chance to kind of pick a date and time that works for them. Check your calendars. You can call into the office if you can't turn this in today. You can certainly turn it in next week. But do let us know you're coming. We'd like to make sure you have plenty of food and plenty of dishes and seating and all that kind of thing. So take the card home with you or turn it in today if you wish, or call into the office at your convenience, and we'll make sure we get you signed up for one of the stewardship dinners that we're all invited to. Also in the course of things coming up this week is the wonderful, the gifted, the inspiring missionary, a man named Paul Jeffrey. I've had the good fortune of hearing him for years. He's been a part of our church through the outreach activities we do in supporting him in his mission work. He's traveled the world. He's a photojournalist and a gifted speaker, and he's a very inspired man of God. And he's going to be here. It's such a treat when he's in town. It's this Tuesday night, following Spirit Cafe. So come on down and join us for dinner worship. We open the dinner at 5:45, worship's at 6:15. And then after the dinner's done and we've cleaned up, we'll let Paul take over probably around 7:30 to begin his presentation. So hopefully you'll come see Paul Jeffrey. If you haven't ever seen him, make an effort. If you've seen him, well, I don't have to tell you anymore. You'll be there if you can, I know. So that's this Tuesday night. Next Saturday, we are inviting all of the leaders of the church, people who are working behind the scenes on committees and task forces and subgroups and council groups and, oh my gosh, any of you who have volunteered behind the scenes to help run this church, we're going to gather for a leadership summit this Saturday. We've told you about it a little bit over the last several weeks. We hope all of you can make it as we continue to work towards the goals of SHIFT. We've been talking about SHIFT quite a bit. We even had the author of the book SHIFT here in our community last month, Dr. Phil Maynard. So please try to make it if you can, even if you can only be for some of it. You know, we'd love to see you there. Sunday the 23rd, a week from tonight, today is the Brandy Novay concert where she's doing a fundraiser for her school district out there, Wright School District. That's this neighborhood that we're involved with where R.L. Stevens is. So you want to come support music in our schools, we'd love to see you out here for an afternoon at 4 o'clock. Gosh, there's more things on the list, but I'm going to leave it at that for now as we've got other things going on as well to take care of this morning. And hopefully you're having a good morning already and you're ready to stand and greet each other, because I want to make sure everybody has a chance to say hello before we get started this morning. So take a second, stand up as you're able, and go say hi to someone you haven't seen yet this morning.
Yeah.
Well, we do indeed call upon you, O Lord, here at this time of gathering, this sacred act of weekly devotion, this time where we can come to connect with friends, fellow sojourners, this community of faith-seeking people. And we come to you with open hearts, come to you with cleared minds and willing spirits as we reach out to you, embracing all that you have in store for us this week, but also giving over to you all that we carry with us from the week past. And we thank you that we've been so blessed to have this time in this church with you and all these wonderful people. Amen. And speaking of wonderful people, Elizabeth is here this morning, and she's got something for us on the computer. Let's see how this works.
Good morning. So I brought something a little bit different for you. Ellie's already gotten the look. So she's seeing a picture of Darth Vader here. So I'm going to push play and see what happens. There. So what did you hear? What kind of group maybe made that music?
A band.
Could be a band. Could be a band is usually just wind instruments. Is there anything that maybe other instruments that you heard in there?
Like an orchestra.
An orchestra. What makes an orchestra? What do you have to have a combination of?
Different types of instruments like woodwind, strings,
and percussion, absolutely.
And brass.
So woodwinds, brass, maybe percussion, timpani, all those things all come together. So was that music kind of exciting? And if I let that play a little bit longer, I know you guys know the Star Wars song, right? Yeah, something we've all heard before. But there's parts of it that are really loud and banging and crashing and cymbaling, right? And then it gets a little bit further into it, and sometimes it's quiet. Sometimes it's maybe just one flute that plays. And it kind of makes you think inside yourself. Maybe it kind of brings you down, right? And brings you into yourself. So did you know that our church is like an orchestra? Did you know that? So just like in an orchestra, all of these players are given special abilities to play their instrument. Sometimes they're loud and clashing and cranky. Sometimes they're quiet. Sometimes they're pretty mellow. But each one of them has a special talent to play that instrument, right? And God gave them those special talents, right? Did God give us special talents as a church to be that orchestra, to be a different kind of orchestra? What kind of orchestra did God give us talents to be, do you think? What do you think?
Followers.
Okay, so people, they're following the conductor, right? Okay, that's one. What else? If God gave you a quieter instrument to play, what kind of things in the church could you be part of?
Praying.
You could be a prayer. You could be a prayer. Anything else? Things that are quiet that help God's orchestra work together. What if you were to visit somebody that wasn't feeling so well? Would that be a cymbal loud crashing going into their house? No. It's a quiet instrument, but it's still doing part of God's work, right? It's still playing in the instrument. What if you were a loud trumpet? What kind of things could you be doing for God as you're a loud trumpet? That's kind of a different question. Could you be going out into the world and maybe helping somebody that didn't have a voice for themselves, and you're that loud voice talking to the people who can change the world? Absolutely. That would be a nice trumpet. Yeah. How about if we all work together and created this kind of orchestra, makes beautiful music together, the prayers, the players, and the people who are loud and crashing cymbals out in the world. We work on that today, or this last, next week or so, next months, the next years. We all play our instruments, and sometimes we play them quietly and softly, and sometimes we're really loud, and sometimes we are just making beautiful music together. Let's go out with a prayer. Dear God, thank you for showing us that we can be instruments of your love, of your peace. Put us together and to make a beautiful orchestra and send us out into your world and just help everybody understand the special gifts that each of us has and how to play them together. In your name we pray. Amen.
Bye. Our scripture this morning is from the book of Exodus, chapter 1, verses 15 through 22. Then the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you serve as midwife to the Hebrew women and see them upon the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill him. But if it's a daughter, let her live." But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the male children live. So the king of Egypt called the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this? And let the male children live." The midwives said to Pharaoh, midwives, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every son that is born to the Hebrews, you shall cast into the Nile."
It's a shame Elizabeth isn't still here. I've always wanted to walk on to the Imperial March, especially when I have the black robe on, right? This is, okay, maybe not. Someday. We'll get Mike next week, maybe. Let us take a moment and pray, and may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So this past weekend, not today and yesterday, but last weekend, we celebrated what my grandmother called one of the most useless American holidays there ever is. Columbus Day offended her on a deep level, and it wasn't because she was particularly akin to the plight of Native Americans. It was more to do with the fact that they had named a holiday after an Italian, and ethnic divisions run strong in Western Pennsylvania. Why is there not a Lech Walesa Day after the Slavs? Why only Christopher Columbus, Christoph Colombo, as she would say, just an excuse to sell mattresses? And the one you have already is fine anyway, Depression era. I always thought it was perhaps to instill in us the one poem that all Americans can recite by heart. I'll say the first line, you repeat it. In 1492,
Columbus sailed the ocean blue.
The less known second stanza includes some interesting facts about how he enslaved races and pillaged the Caribbean and broke treaties with sovereign nations, but it was harder to get that to rhyme. So we'll just stick with him sailing the ocean blue. It starts this morning with a broken and forgotten treaty. Actually, the Hebrews are in Egypt because of Joseph, their ancestor. Joseph, who was actually enslaved himself and rose out of slavery only to be the most loyal of servants to Pharaoh. Only to be the one that brought Pharaoh his wealth. Only to be the one who served Pharaoh as though he himself were Egyptian. But then, time has a funny way of passing, and people who have some wealth kind of forget how they got it. And really quickly, this new Pharaoh forsakes the Hebrews. Before there was the gift of blankets laced with smallpox, there was an edict from Pharaoh on the Nile. Who does he think he is to dish out life and death? He thinks he's Pharaoh. That's who. He thinks he's Pharaoh in ancient Egypt. He is God on earth. This is actually well within his rights to kill half of the Hebrew children. And so when he summons the Hebrew midwives to them, when he says, when you're on the birthing stool, if it is a boy, kill him, Pharaoh just expects the Hebrew midwives to do this, right? Things were so different then. Men who had money and power thought they could just make women do whatever they wanted. We wouldn't really understand that, would we? No reference at all. I digress. It is not Pharaoh who interests me. It is not Pharaoh who interests me because powerful, wealthy bullies are a dime a dozen. And they get more of our attention than they deserve. Shifra and Pua are the ones who are worthy of our time. This morning, they are among only a handful of women who are named in Scripture, not because they are the mother of some man or the wife of some man, but rather they are named because of who they are, because they stand on their own feet, or perhaps because they sit on their own stool. According to one Midrash, Shifra and Pua are mother and daughter, the first example of a successful Jewish family business who begets the Levitic line, that is, that the sons they save become the priests of the high temple. In the Passover story, they are the first heroes. They are the first heroes. Their resistance to the most powerful man in the world is the beginning of the liberation of Israel. I have thought of this story so much in recent weeks. That is, the story we were reading this morning was originally going to be about the burning bush, but I have been seeing what has been happening in North Dakota, in places where people must resist the powerful among them. If you don't know what's going on in North Dakota, there's something called the Dakota Access Pipeline that is being built from North Dakota to take crude oil to refineries in Chicago. And along the route, it goes through many supposedly sovereign nations, nations that were granted to people when we thought there wasn't any value to that land. Now that there is, the treaty might be adjusted. And the people there, the Sioux people, have concern that the route will destroy the environment, that it will go through their sacred burial grounds. And while they have put an injunction into the court to stop construction, the construction has continued anyway. Every person has a voice. It's just that some voices don't get listened to. Sometimes the only option people have is to speak with their body and get in the way. It is a compelling act of resistance. And I wrote a not compelling, but pretty good, reasonable sermon on this act of resistance. That was sermon number 2 of 6 that I wrote this week. Sometimes it goes that way. Sometimes it takes a while to wrestle the text to the ground, and even then you realize that you are the one pinned underneath. Because the problem for me with this story, like with the Shifra and Puah, the Jewish midwife story, is that for most of us, I wonder, so what? So what? Most of us in this room, while we may have the experience of sometimes being alienated, I will speak for myself. I don't have the experience of being an indigenous person in North Dakota. No one has tried to steal my land from under me. I certainly don't have the experience of being enslaved like I was in Egypt. So what does this text say to us? And this is what I love about scripture. Just when we think we've come to the end, there is a new beginning. Several people before me have wrestled with this text. People through the ages have picked apart this story. There is the midrash of the successful Jewish family business, but perhaps the midrash that speaks to us is this compelling midrash in which Shifra and Puah are not Jewish at all. That is, a very clever rabbi looks at the phrase Hebrew midwives and realizes that in Hebrew, that adjective could mean that the women are Hebrew, but it could also mean that they are midwives to the Hebrews. And when I read that text, that actually made a lot more sense. Shifra and Puah are Egyptian. Of course, if Pharaoh is God on earth, why would he summon slave women to talk to them? And if Pharaoh has half of a brain in him, which we assume he might, though that's not always, you know, required to be in power, we might find that he would think, hey, you know, it's going to be difficult to get women to kill their own sons, right? And so wouldn't it make sense that if he would entertain women in a private audience, it would be Egyptian women, women who he would think would have the same racist cultural leanings as he, women who would be very attuned to following him because they would want their husbands and their sons to rise up in power in his court? Would he not summon Egyptian women because he would think that they would have no trouble at all seeing the Hebrews as less than human? They would have no trouble at all killing the Hebrew babies. If this is the case, then why don't they? Why don't they? The scripture says it is because they fear God, but barring a 20th century understanding of universal spirituality, how is it that Egyptian women come to know a Hebrew God? This was sermons 5 and 6. How is it that Egyptian women come to know a Hebrew God? Oh, I wrestled with it. I looked at several texts. I brought out ridiculous books that are way too big that were written long before even my parents were born. And I just kept wrestling with it and wrestling with it. And finally, one evening, I was at a meeting where some people are organizing actually to stand in solidarity with the people in Standing Rock, North Dakota. And a friend of mine who is an indigenous person herself is very perceptive and noticed that I was tuned out for most of the meeting. And so I posed to her this wrenching theological question, expecting she would be so interested and so captivated as I was. And she said, "Are you serious? Is that what you've been thinking about? I don't even know that story," she said. "I'm not even Christian, but it's really clear that the Egyptian midwives know the Hebrew God, Because they know the Hebrew babies. Duh. Where was she on Tuesday? She wasn't there on Tuesday. The Hebrew babies are the ones that show the Egyptian midwives the Hebrew God. There is a theological term for it, imago Dei, made in the image of God. That is Shifra and Puha know the Hebrew God because they delivered Hebrew baby after Hebrew baby. And for whatever they had heard about Hebrews being less than human, they noticed that Hebrew babies, when they come out, are sort of red and wrinkly, just like other babies. And sometimes the head's a little pointy, and first-time mothers get really nervous that the head will always look that way. And then you have to reassure them, no, the head will even out. It will be okay. And Hebrew women, like Egyptian women, regardless of what they have gone through, reach for their child to begin the nursing. That is, whatever the source it is, whatever source it is for all things, God, if that's what they would call him, it is the same source for each person. To know the person, imago Dei, is to know God. For you have seen the face of God before you and lived. That may seem like an obvious truth for us. That may seem like an obvious truth that we know. And I'm someone who likes to know things, right? I'm someone who busts out the big books. And when I'm thinking about things, I tend to sequester in my room and really try to know it with my brain. And last week, I really saw the error of that. That is, some of our youth came and spoke at a couple of the services about Sierra's service project. I don't know what they shared here at Montgomery, but what they shared at Stony Point was about painting a shed. I was about putting up a handrail, which of course begs the theological question, was it your first time using an impact drill? How was that for you? Which bit did they give you? Are you wanting to go back? I have power. Well, that's my own line of thought. Where they went after that, when Jacob asked them to share other thoughts, was one young man, after he had talked about the impact drill, also talked about the impact of broken treaties between the U.S. government and the native people in Chiloquin, Oregon. That is, he quickly made the connection between having the resources of your land pillaged and now there being poverty in your land. He probably could have read that information in a book. Given his age, he probably would have found it on the internet. But it's one thing to know something, and it's one thing to really know something. That is, what I read and hold in my mind doesn't necessarily come out in my body. Shifra and Puah's names are not written into scripture because they know the God of Israel and they wrote a compelling sermon about it. Their names are in scripture because they knew the God of Israel with their hands on the birthing stool. They knew the God of Israel when the male baby was born, and they said, I'm just gonna pretend I didn't see that part. Let's move him along, right? They knew the God of Israel, the God of truth, when coincidentally they go back to face the most powerful man in the world, and they lie to his face, because sometimes that is the only way, that is the only way that marginalized people can have their voices heard. They knew how to love the least among them, and in that knowing, they knew the love of God. This is good news. This is good news because if you are someone who hasn't heard the call of God in a burning bush, and a booming voice that I always imagine sounds like James Earl Jones. If you haven't heard a calling from God that way, blessed are you. Perhaps the calling is coming from something more precious. Perhaps God is calling you through the person right in front of you, the one way made in God's image. And sometimes the way to tell that it is a real calling, that you are really seeing God, is if there is some risk involved. That is, let us not hallmarkify this moment between the Egyptian midwives and the Hebrew babies. Those women take their own lives into their hands and risk everything because the love of God, knowing the other person and seeing the image of God in that person, is so compelling that it would make you risk everything else. God blesses them. God blesses them with their own families, but God blesses them with something far more important, something that they actually never see. They don't see the deliverance of the people of Israel. They just see the deliverance of one baby and another. For me, what that means in my life is that I will have no idea what impact seeing another person could have on me and the world, and maybe I will never know. But that doesn't mean that the Spirit isn't working through it. Just because you have not seen the Passover come doesn't mean that it isn't happening right now. Our job is not to see the liberation of all the people. Our job is to see the person God places right before us. The people who it would be more convenient not to see, but who, through the love of God, we are compelled to look at anyway. Who is that person for you? It may take you a moment to draw them to mind, because by nature, if it's the person you don't see, you've probably been trying not to see them. But who is that person for you? For me, it's this neighbor across the street who's always trying to talk to me when I'm jumping on my bicycle and I have like the computer or the food or the dog and I'm weighed down and I'm just trying to get there. And she keeps reaching out to me and it's so inconvenient. But maybe I actually really need to stop and see her and give myself the extra 25 to 40 minutes I imagine she needs to tell her story. Who is that person? Is it the person who is standing outside of the convenience store asking you for $2? Is it the person in your family who it is easier to not remember exists, but you realize Thanksgiving is coming? Who is it who you have not seen, and do you know that that person is made in the image of God? Do you know that that person is made in the image of God? And perhaps in taking the risk in seeing them, you may actually see the face of God and not only live, but live more abundantly than you can imagine. I don't know how God could use that moment in your life, but I know that in responding to God's call, things have changed in mine. And I would pray to God that each of us would be open to how God is being manifest and present before us. Each of us would be willing to take the risk to see the other, knowing that however God will use that moment, it will be beyond our imagination. Amen.
Thank you.
As we prepare for our time of prayer, I hope you've taken a moment to read through the Caring Corner, as well as the new information that's come forward this last week. We celebrated the life of Florence Harner, and beautiful flowers here in remembrance of her. We recognize the passing of Lona Waller, whose services are scheduled on the 29th of October. And we sadly got the news of Derek Lane's passing this week as well. And we'll keep you posted about plans for his family's get together for the celebration of his life. So hold all these folks in your prayers this morning, please. Let us pray. O Holy Spirit, truth divine, give you thanks for this time together and for this weekend that we experienced recently, where the storms came and dried our lands and gave us a welcome soaking. Those dramatic winds and those pelting rains provided us with a good opportunity to stay indoors and maybe to do some reading or take a nap, maybe just be with good company. And over the years in our lives, it's been times like these where we've been cooped up at home that some of our fondest memories have been made. And as this past week has gone, dear God, since we were last together, for many of us, it's been a quiet one. We've been fortunate that our daily routines have passed normally. We're doing fairly well, and our lives are pretty satisfying. Our family and friends seem good. But we know, too, that there are others here who struggled this past week. Some who've been verbally attacked. Others who've received bad news about their health. Some have lost people close to them. We know there's people here who've lost their jobs or are not happy with those jobs. Some have been fighting with their loved ones. Others are suffering financially, feeling dispirited, or simply hungering for a decent meal and needing a warm night's sleep. And so, whoever we are, and with whatever's on our hearts and our minds, we come to you now in this time of prayer, each of us raising our own inner voice humbly to you. We ask you to receive our personal words and our thoughts, and give us your wisdom and your comfort as we pause for a moment of silence. No matter what this past week may have brought to each of us, we now look ahead to the week to come. And we know the promise of your Son, Jesus, who teaches us that you are always with us, good times or bad. And we know, too, how much a life lived in devotion to you can bring us hope and make a difference in our outlook. And so we give thanks and know we are blessed to have this church, these people, its leaders, to guide and support us. We ask you to reveal to us, O Holy One, our ignorance in not seeing your ways, and help us to experience gratefully how your blessings flow. For it's because of our human condition that we must be constantly reminded of your abundant and ever-present love, especially as we mire ourselves in our own self-righteousness, or we turn away from injustice, or we allow to fester the suffering that we have in our own lives. Please, God, give us the minds and the hearts to be humble and true, and the courage to reach out in your name to all those who come into our lives. Help us to see all those unseen, and let us show unerringly the love and the faith that our brother Jesus taught us, so that we can be the people who you want us to be, the people who you expect us to be. With humbled hearts and bowed heads, we come to you with grateful hearts, knowing all the blessings that we have can only be given to you in a symbol of the offering that we make this morning. Amen.
Would you join with me in prayer? Creator God, you who are the God of Shifra and Puah and Miriam and Deborah and Ruth and Naomi and Mary and Martha, we praise you. We praise you for your mighty acts of creation and for having created us in your own image. We praise you and we give you thanks. We give you thanks for these gifts, a portion of which we return to you. May it be a sign and a symbol and a renewal of our covenant to be your people. Indeed, you have been our God. We confess to you that we have not always been good stewards of your creation. We have not always seen how the other is made in your image too. We are humble before you. Our offering to you as a contrite heart. We know this you will not despise. Send your spirit again. Send your spirit again. Make us more like you. Open our eyes to see the other before us. Open our ears to listen to stories from the people who have a voice, and open our mouths to pray with boldness the prayer our brother Jesus taught us. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy desire be God, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
That's great. Let's stand and sing, Be Thou My Vision.
And so let us go forth knowing that the God of Shifra and Puah is with us, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, God seeks to open our eyes to each other, that we might see how we are all made in God's image, that our hearts may be changed, and through us, the world transformed. Amen.